Welcome back to Math the World. In parts 1 and 2 of this video series, we analyzed the optimal angle to take to the curb in order to have the best chance of evading an oncoming vehicle. We found that the distances in this situation don't affect the optimal angle, but what about the speed? What if Sarah's crossing a highway instead and the truck's going 70 miles an hour? Should she still aim for 18.6 degrees? Or what if she's crossing a residential street but she's running full speed across the road to beat the traffic? Which we do not condone, by the way. In that situation, her speed would be much closer to the car's speed, so what angle should she take then? The speeds in the soccer and football situations are also quite different. In football, the speeds of a defensive back and the ball carrier are pretty close, but in soccer, the ball can be traveling much faster than the goalkeeper can move. In this video, we're going to figure out how the speeds affect the optimal angle, and we'll use calculus to help us better understand these situations and show how to analyze a general mathematical model, one with parameters instead of specific values. Welcome back to Math the World. In the last video, we used some trig to create a function that outputs the amount of time a pedestrian is safe on the curb before a vehicle passes by. We called this the safety time. And it inputs the angle the pedestrian takes to get to the curb. We had some initial assumptions for distances and speeds, but in this video, let's make that model more general by working with some arbitrary values for speeds and distances. This is a typical approach when working with a mathematical model. It helps us better understand the real-world phenomenon occurring. This approach has some advantages. We'll discuss those as we go through the problem. The form of the function for calculating safety time comes from calculating the difference in the time it takes the pedestrian to get to the curb and the truck to get to the pedestrian. We calculate the time as distance divided by rate. So we have truck's travel distance divided by truck speed minus pedestrian's travel distance to the curb divided by the pedestrian speed. Here's the model from the last video with the distances and speeds we used initially. Below that model, we have displayed our general model on the screen with two different distances and two different speeds as parameters. The two distances are the initial distance between the pedestrian and the truck, and the initial perpendicular distance between the pedestrian and the curb. In this video, we will use calculus to find the optimal angle in terms of these parameters. We'll use the derivative of our function and set it equal to zero. Now, since not all viewers have had calculus, this might be new to some. Here's a quick overview of the idea of a derivative. We're starting with a function that has an angle as an input and the amount of safety time as the output. But the derivative of this function is another function that outputs the rate that the safety time is changing at any angle. When the rate is positive, the pedestrian is gaining time as the angle increases. When the rate is negative, the pedestrian is losing time as the angle increases. So we want to find the angle the pedestrian would take when they have stopped gaining time and would start losing time if the pedestrian went at any larger angle. This will happen when the output of the derivative function shows a change from positive to negative, or in other words, when the derivative function has a value of zero. So we're looking for the angle that gives the derivative function an output of zero. This gives us the optimal angle because the pedestrian will have gained as much time as possible, and any greater angle would start to decrease the safety time from this maximum. Using the derivation techniques taught in calculus, we can find the derivative of our function. We'll call the derivative function t prime. To find the angle that gives the maximum safety time, we set the derivative equal to zero and solve for x. With specific numbers, we could graph this function and find where it crosses zero. Without the numbers, we need to solve algebraically instead. That may seem like a disadvantage at first, but this process helps us to learn a lot about the situation and can result in a formula for the optimal angle that we can apply in other situations. Already, we can notice that the derivative of the function does not depend on the distance between the truck and the pedestrian. That parameter doesn't show up in the derivative, so it can't affect the optimal angle. As we solve, notice that the distance from the pedestrian to the curb divides out, so that parameter also doesn't affect the optimal angle. We learned this in the last video, but had to just try changing values in the function to see how that would affect the graph. Finally, we end up with a simple formula for the optimal angle. X equals the arc sine of the pedestrian speed divided by the speed of the truck. Turns out only the speeds determine the optimal angle. But it is even easier than that. Only the ratio of the speeds matter, or the relative speeds matter. If the pedestrian speed is half the truck speed, it doesn't matter what the actual speeds are. The optimal angle would be the same in those situations. I want to stop here for a moment and point out a few advantages that using a general model with parameters has over using one with specific values. First, there's no computation. Instead, we use the power of algebra in our analysis. Second, we can see how each parameter affects the solution. As some of the parameters disappeared through the process, we knew they didn't affect the optimal angle. the ones that are still in, make it easier for us to understand the solution. Third, we now have a general formula for the optimal angle that we can apply to other situations without rehashing the work we did in the last video. Let's get back to our expression for the optimal angle. We can simplify the formula even further by replacing the ratio with one parameter, or variable. We can call it x equals arcsine of r. This is extremely helpful in understanding these escape or intercept situations. What does it mean if r is greater than 1? Then the pedestrian is faster than the truck, and the pedestrian can just run away from the truck and take their time getting to the curb. It's not realistic or interesting. In fact, the model does not give an optimal angle for this situation since the sine ratios are between 1 and a negative 1. But what if r is less than 1? Then the pedestrian is going slower than the truck, and the optimal angle gets closer and closer to being a direct path to the curb as r approaches 0. That means in a situation when the truck is much faster than the pedestrian, the optimal solution is to basically head directly to the curb. Let's apply this a little to our other situations. This means in soccer, if the penalty kick is hard, so it's traveling much faster than the goalkeeper, then jumping a little away from the goal line to attack the path of the ball perpendicularly is better. It still might not be enough. If the goalkeeper's too slow, they won't be able to get to the ball in time. But so far, the model predicts that that's the best chance they have. We'll see if this holds up with further analysis in a later video. The football situation is different than the pedestrian situation, though, in two ways. First, the defensive back and the ball carrier are roughly the same speed. If they're exactly the same, then the value of r is 1, and the optimal angle is 90 degrees. That means the defensive back should run directly down the field and not toward the ball carrier at all. Well, that's optimal because we picked the best angle to maximize the safety time, and running directly down the field basically keeps that time at infinity. We don't have exhaustion or end zones in our current mathematical model. This brings up the other way that the defensive back situation is different. The defensive back is trying to get hit by the truck, just the far corner of the truck. So the defensive back's not trying to maximize the time. They're trying to take an angle where the safety time is essentially zero. This will call for a different analysis of our model, which we'll do in a later video linked below. All right, as a quick summary, what we did in this video is we wrote down a general model with parameters representing the initial conditions of the situation. We took the derivative of our safety time function to find the angle that maximized the safety time. We found a formula for the optimal angle. The optimal angle only depends on the relative speeds in the situation, and we used what we learned to start to make sense of the soccer and the football situations. We also saw some of the advantages of using a general model, rather than one with specific values. The general model made it easier to understand how the different quantities in the situation, the distances and speeds, impacted the optimal angle, and it made it easier to find a general formula to apply to other situations. What's your favorite math problem? Share it with us in the comments. It doesn't have to be a modeling or real-world problem. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.